Ladies and gentlemen. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the fall of the wall at Eureka College, the only institution in the United States of America that holds an annual ceremony to celebrate the fall of the Berlin Wall, the symbolic end of the Cold War, the victory for freedom over Soviet atheistic totalitarianism. This is Eureka College Fall of the Wall. Welcome to everyone, our special guests, our outstanding chorale, best in America. We will see today a parade of flags that has become a wonderful tradition. We are joined by President Jamel Wright in her first Fall of the Wall ceremony as president of Eureka College. Welcome, Dr. Wright. We are joined by President Claire Cooley, the student body president, walking in the footsteps of another student body president from the class of 1932 named Dutch Reagan. Madam President, welcome. We will hear from our chaplain, which is appropriate to always hear from the chaplain here at Eureka College. Bruce Folks, thank you for being here. And we are truly honored to be joined by Nancy and Jim Rosebush. The Honorable James S. Rosebush will give us keynote remarks today in his unique insights and personal relationship with President Ronald Reagan and Mrs. Reagan, and we'll hear more from him later. Rosebush is welcome for your first visit to Eureka College. Today and this week, we remember the fall of the Berlin Wall, November 9th, 1989. Tomorrow, we think of our friends in the United States Marine Corps, the birthday of the U.S. Marines. Our first speaker for the fall of the wall was the General P.X. Kelly, former Commandant of the United States Marine Corps, the oldest living Commandant of the Marine Corps, who came here in 2009 to inaugurate the fall of the Berlin Wall ceremony. We think of P.X. today on this week as our first speaker, and we think of the birthday of his beloved Marine Corps tomorrow, and we think of our veterans on this Veterans Day week. Thank God for the veterans. At this time, I would like to ask all of the veterans who are with us today if you would please stand so that we may recognize you. And before you do, I would like to point out one particular veteran this year who is a special guest of Carl Hirsch's today. He served at Iwo Jima. He won two Purple Hearts. His name is Milt Steffen. And Milt, if you would stand and if you would be joined by all of the other veterans in the room to be recognized by all of us in appreciation. We thank you for your service. We are joined today by members of the Board of Trustees who are present with us. If you would rise, if you are a current or past member of the Board of Trustees, so that we may celebrate your service to this great college. Board of Trustees. We are joined today by Mike and Judy Mangold. Mike serves on the Board of Trustees, is a generous donor and member of the Ronald Reagan Society in many other ways, but he is also today's sponsor of the Fall of the Wall, which he has done every year since our beginning. And we thank the Mangold family and Mangold Ford for your support for this extraordinary occasion. Thank you, Mangolds. We also thank PNC Bank and the other members of the Ronald Reagan Society who support us so generally. We are joined today by the Chancellor of Eureka College, Dr. J. David Arnold. Dr. Arnold, thank you for being here. And I think we are joined in spirit by that kid who ran around this college almost a century ago now, Dutch Reagan, who gave his first speech of a political nature on the stage of the chapel just up the hill from here, where he learned to stand up for what he believed was right. And later he would stand up in front of the Brandenburg Gate in Berlin, and he would utter what has become his most famous and eloquent statement, the desire for freedom. Mr. Gorbachev, come here to this gate. Open this gate. Mr. Gorbachev, and then he repeated it. Mr. Gorbachev, will you join me in saying the rest? Tear down this wall. And that wall would come down November 9th, 1989, greater freedom for the people of 24 nations of the world, free, freer, or still fighting for freedom today, that resulted. We thank everyone for being here. To begin our ceremony today, please help me welcome Dr. Joseph Henry, the director of the Eureka College Chorale. Please rise for the singing of the national anthem. Thank you, Chorale. You may be seated. To give us our invocation today, please welcome the Reverend Bruce Folks, the chaplain of Eureka College.
Would you join me in prayer? Lord, according to your wise teacher in Ecclesiastes, there's a time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to reap and a time to sow, a time to keep silent and a time to speak. Clearly, God, we, your creatures, get the timing all wrong sometimes. We build up when we should be tearing down. We keep silent when we should speak out. We divide when we should unify. Forgive us our poor timing, especially when it brings suffering or injustice or conflict. Today we remember a moment in time when a convergence of voices, aspirations, events, and leaders brought a fullness of time, a time when tearing down became an occasion to dance on rubble, an occasion to embrace across what had been a kill zone, when bright visions of peace replaced the chilling shadow of war. Today we celebrate a moment when the world was liberated from a wall that ultimately failed to contain the aspirations of its people. Bless our celebration. Bless our peaceful transition of power. Bless our veterans. Help us to truly believe in the heroic that is in all of us, the opportunities to follow our greater angels, to live according to our highest principles, to the kind that inspired two powerful leaders to set aside what divided them in order to bring down a wall that split nation from nation, countrymen from countrymen, family from family. Come to us now, O God, with that same spirit of reconciliation and expose our self-imposed walls of politics and class, race, nationality, and religion. And thereby help us to catch a fleeting glimpse of how you see us, Lord, one human family, your beloved sons and daughters, one and all held close to you because of no merit of our own, but simply because we are all your beloved. Then, having seen ourselves in your gracious light, may we see others with that same brilliance. Walk among us. Make yourself known to us, God, whose love knows no boundaries. Amen.
Thank you, Bruce. The chairman of the Board of Trustees, Bill King, could not be with us today, but he was here last year, and he called and excitedly gave me a recollection from the past. The ceremony you're about to see is unique, as far as we know, in all of higher education. It will be led by the president of our student body, as it has since the year 2009. And Bill called and recollected that as each of these flags are brought in, which represent the 24 nations that were once under the thumb of Soviet totalitarianism, under the Eastern Bloc and Soviet republics, and today, as I said, are free, freer, or in some cases still struggling for their full freedom, you will see just one of the most remarkable outcomes of leadership, leadership of the United States and the Western world, leadership of those who believed in freedom, leadership of people behind the Iron Curtain who believed, the power of transformation. And I think for those students at Eureka College who will themselves go on to help transform the world, it could not be a more pronounced and amazing a celebration of outcomes than the resulting freedom of the fall of the Berlin Wall and the end of the Cold War. And so it is really special, and I hope that all of us here at Eureka and our supporters and our friends in the community will, as Bill King said, just sit back and contemplate how absolutely incredible it is to look at each of these flags as they are brought forward. The person I'm about to introduce is the representative of the greatest student body of any college in the country, Eureka College. She's a dynamic leader for the student senate and the student body. Some of you heard her. Did anybody hear her opening convocation speech this year? How about that? Yes, indeed. She did not bring her rain boots today, though. But those were good. Please help me welcome the president of the student body of Eureka College to lead us, and I have to make one more point before I bring you forward, lead us in the parade of flags that will be accompanied by a beautiful piece of perhaps the greatest symphony ever written by Beethoven, the Ninth Symphony. And I just want to mention that when you hear this music that will accompany Claire as she finishes her remarks and brings these flags forward, this is the actual recording of the Ninth Symphony under the direction of Leonard Bernstein in Berlin on Christmas Day, 1989, just weeks after the wall came down. The greatest musicians from around the world flew to Berlin to play in this orchestral presentation. And this, what you hear today, will be the actual recording of that symphonic Christmas Day presentation in 1989. Please help me welcome the student body president, Eureka College, Claire Cooley.
Thank you. Okay. Good afternoon. My name is Claire Cooley, and I am the current student body president of Eureka College. We are gathered here today to mark the 27th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall. On the night of November 9th, 1989, East Berlin's Communist Party announced that citizens were free to cross the country's borders. Starting at midnight that night, crowds flocked to the wall and began to pick away at the obstruction that had symbolized the Cold War. Walls represent a divide, a way to keep one side out, and an exclusionary tactic that seems to be the most effective. I can only imagine what it would have been like to take a hammer to something that attempted to stunt your progression and keep you from your family and better opportunities. Walls don't create countries, they destroy them. When I was a freshman in high school, my family hosted a German exchange student. Friederike Schule is from Tübingen, Germany, but both of her parents are from Russia. I asked her recently what brought her parents and grandparents from Russia to Germany, and she told me that there were better opportunities and a hope for a better tomorrow. They arrived in Germany in 1991, and 2 years after, or 2 years after the wall fell, they saw a prosperous life in Germany that could not be provided in Russia. The wall represented a divide among nations, ideas, and families. When the wall fell, a flood of migrants from the east confronted the west. The breaking of the barriers allowed families to be reunited, cultures to be reintroduced, and ideas to live in coexistence. Today, we are celebrating and remembering those who were affected by the wall. For Freddie and her family, the wall falling meant they could experience opportunities that might have otherwise been impossible. On behalf of the student body, I am pleased to read the names of each of these nations, once under Soviet communism, and now free, freer, or still struggling for freedom. Eureka College stands with these nations. Each flag will be carried onto the stage by a Eureka College student for the celebration. The flags will be led by the American flag as a symbol for how our country continues to lead the world in the cause of freedom. Please rise for the parade of flags. The United States of America. The Republic of Albania. The Republic of Armenia. The Republic of Azerbaijan. The Republic of Belarus. Bosnia and Herzegovina. The Republic of Bulgaria. The Republic of Croatia. The Czech Republic. The Republic of Estonia. Georgia. The Federal Republic of Germany. Hungary. The Republic of Kazakhstan. The Republic of Latvia. The the Republic of Lithuania. The Republic of Macedonia. Montenegro. The Republic of Poland. Romania. The Russian Federation. The Slovak Republic. The Republic of Serbia. The Republic of Slovenia. Ukraine. Thank you very much. Please post your flags.
Ladies and gentlemen, how about that? The flags of freedom. Would you please help me give a special thank you to Eureka College student and member of the United States Marine Reserve Corps, Chris Cole. Ladies and gentlemen, Chris Cole. Please be seated. Well, now I have the distinct privilege and pleasure to introduce a dynamic leader for your Eureka College. In her first Fall of the Wall ceremony as president, a graduate of the University of Kansas, master's degree and PhD, expert in communication, a veteran, dynamic teacher with a national reputation for excellence in teaching, from Boston College to St. Louis University, her native hometown, and someone who, out of the starting gate, has stepped into the presidency of Eureka College to lead us to a vision to new heights as to how we represent the best of liberal arts education in this country, who has set us on a uniquely Eureka path, her theme. Anybody have heard uniquely Eureka? Hashtag uniquely Eureka? You'll be hearing it more. Ladies and gentlemen, the president of Eureka College, Dr. Jamel Santa Cruz Wright.
Good afternoon. Thank you, John, for that amazing introduction. And thank you to all of the students from the Chorale, as well as the students who displayed these wonderful flags on the stage. Please give them another round of applause. Great job. So I bring you greetings on behalf of the Eureka College Board of Trustees, our faculty, staff, and students. And I especially welcome our guests Jim and Nancy Rosebush. And I have to say that it is my hope, and I look forward to hearing, as I hope we've provided you, another piece of the puzzle so that we can better understand the full picture and story of this amazing leader whose courage and humility has definitely transcended the many years since his passing and his presidency. So I look forward to you offering those words to us this afternoon, and again, hope that your time on campus provides for you a snapshot into the beginnings of the vision and voice that became President Ronald Reagan. As John mentioned during his statement of the occasion, those words spoken by our alumnus and the subsequent fall of the wall is what brings us together this afternoon and this time every year. It's a celebration of world freedom, the fight for that freedom, and it also gives us an opportunity to honor those who serve to protect our freedom. This is truly a uniquely Eureka event, and it is the only one, near or far, to commemorate this historic occasion. But what is the contemporary significance that makes this occasion so special? Consistent with the values of today's college leaders and that of the Eureka College founders, affiliated with the Christian Church, Disciples of Christ, who were abolitionists with goals of breaking down barriers of difference and inequality, President Reagan spoke those memorable words in 1987 with a similar thought in mind. We all have a role to play in order for freedom to flourish. It was a similar thought when the founders admitted men and women on an equal basis, the first in the state and third in the nation to do so. History tells us that President Reagan was discouraged from making such a statement by many of his circle of advisors, and yet he did so against their advice. This is the type of courage displayed in thought and action that we hope and urge our students today to embrace. This commitment to civic engagement and justice will build upon the 161-year legacy of Eureka College founders, alumni, faculty, staff, and friends of the college who have done all they can to make the world a better place. Our remembrance of this significant historical moment provides an example for our students who may find themselves in similar situations where they too can openly embrace a position to break down barriers of injustice and challenge systems that threaten or stymie people's access to opportunity, even when it may not be popular to do so. President Reagan, much like our students here today, benefit from the experience of a liberal arts education. We should all remember the power of a liberal arts education to train and challenge students, to encourage them to do what our founders and what President Reagan did on that given day. We should be reminded that it's this small college in central Illinois that provided Dutch the place and space to find his vision and voice, and to know that his words could be influential. His words, "Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall," were indeed influential. So I thank you all for joining us in this celebration today. I ask for your continued support and prayers, and I ask you to welcome with open minds and hearts the wonderful stories and words that you will hear next from our fantastic guest who has joined us. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Wright. You know, Eureka College is the smallest of the now 23 colleges in American history to have graduated a president of the United States. And there are many different ways that our sort of omnipresent Ronald, did anybody know that Ronald Reagan graduated from Eureka College? Have you heard that? There are many ways in which this story, just one of thousands of stories of successful servant leadership in the world, but one in which is in every history book. Every fifth grade history book in this country has a little box that says Ronald Reagan graduated from Eureka College. This is our Reagan, this is our story, the story of liberal arts and leadership, the story of, as Dr. Wright just said, someone who discovered his vision and voice. And so it is really remarkable when we're able to bring folks to campus as we have throughout the years, from Mikhail Gorbachev, who spoke here in 2009, the very man from which Ronald Reagan demanded the wall come down, to those he appointed who would change the course of history, Justice Sandra Day O'Connor, the first woman appointed to the United States Supreme Court in history by Ronald Reagan. And so with the dozens and dozens of extraordinary speakers, many of whom some in the audience have seen, and you students have seen some, it is really a special privilege to bring someone like Jim Rosebush to campus today, and especially that Nancy could be with you. For Jim Rosebush was appointed at a very young age to the White House staff to work as deputy assistant to the President of the United States, newly elected Ronald Reagan. And Mr. Rosebush was appointed to work on one of President Reagan's most important programs to him, the private sector initiatives. But there was someone else living in that White House who was extraordinarily important to the success of President Reagan, who was with him at every turn. And it is in this room in March of this past year that we held a memorial service, again, the only college in America to do so. Mrs. Nancy Reagan, herself with Illinois roots. She would summer in Galesburg. She had connections to Chicago, just as Ronald Reagan had connections to Illinois. Jim Rosebush was asked by the president if he would take on the role, in addition to working as his deputy assistant, as chief of staff to the First Lady of the United States. Some say Mrs. Reagan may have been the most influential and significant First Lady, certainly since Eleanor Roosevelt, if not ever. Quietly, behind the scenes, the role she played in supporting her husband. So to the students particularly, I would say, when you have a chance to hear from someone, as we will momentarily, who had a front row seat, who traveled around the world with the most powerful leadership position there is on planet Earth, and who was the closest person connected to the closest person to the president, Mrs. Reagan, it is a rare treat. He is a graduate of a liberal arts college himself, Principia College. Anybody ever heard of Principia? We beat them, we play them from time to time in sports. And I'm sure they beat us. It's a fair game. Here in Illinois, also a church-founded school, small, personalized, committed to liberal arts. He understands who we are. He is a renowned expert in philanthropy, corporate foundation philanthropy. He's an advisor to CEOs and corporations around the country and around the globe. And recently, he is the author of a very popular new book called True Reagan. True Reagan. What made Ronald Reagan great and why it matters about the character, something we care a lot about here in the development of our students. True Reagan. So to hear reflections on this anniversary of the fall of Berlin Wall, we, the people of Eureka College, are proud to welcome you, Jim Rosebush.
Thank you. Thank you, John, so much. And a great thanks to the trustees, the faculty, the administration, and to the students, the wonderful students at Eureka College. Thank you so much for this warm welcome. Today is a very important day for us to be welcomed here, where I can tell each of you we feel the spirit of Ronald Reagan. There was always a little bit of a void in my life in the category of my experience with Ronald Reagan, and that is that I had never visited Eureka College. And I can tell you that somehow in the life of the presidential administration, in this case, in Ronald Reagan's White House, Eureka
always had a very special place. And as I served on the president's long-range scheduling team, which took the president on out for a year or 2 years in advance, whenever the name Eureka was brought up, it was always in a revered tone, almost in a hushed way, because we knew what place Eureka College held, not only in the heart of Ronald Reagan, but in his ability to be the great leader of character that he became for the rest of the world. And I have a little message for all of you. After being here today, walking around campus, meeting many of you, hearing comments from many of you, and just imbibing the spirit of this place, I can tell you that Ronald Reagan lives today, right here, his spirit, his character, his faith, and his beliefs are alive, right here at Eureka. And were Reagan really here today to be able to speak to you as I am, I know what he would say, and that would be that the value of Eureka is not in proportion to its size, but in proportion to its goodness. What we just witnessed here was an example of the goodness of Eureka College, of its heart and its commitment, along with Ronald Reagan, to finding and promoting and supporting individual liberty for all mankind. Ronald Reagan's spirit lives on in Eureka. And thank you again so much for inviting us. I've entitled my brief remarks today, "The Fall of the Wall, the Fall of All Walls." On Wednesday evening, November 20th, 1985, Ronald Reagan and I sat before a roaring fire talking. And you know, Ronald Reagan was a big talker. It wasn't an ordinary talk. No, none of mine with the 40th President of the United States ever were. Oh yes, there would be small talk, jokes, arrangements, briefings, but to me, there was always a somewhat mysterious strain of what I eventually learned was his covert spirituality. It ran right beneath the surface, in plain sight, but rarely, if ever, detected. And this was just the way he wanted it to be. Reagan wanted to be remembered for what he accomplished for his fellow Americans, and he wanted to leave them better acquainted with American ideals. He never talked or wrote in his diaries about desiring a legacy, and certainly not to be known for what was going on inside that soulful interior, territory which Nancy Reagan admitted even she could not penetrate. He rarely used the personal pronoun I. He typically deferred to the magnificent and widely honored quotations of the wiser men of epochs gone by and retorted, "It's been said I was a great communicator. I was not a great communicator. It was just that I communicated great ideas." This was the tall, contained gentleman of an earlier era who always strode elegantly and commandingly, yet humbly, across a room in his shiny, pointed, handmade shoes, and who inventively pronounced America to be less of a place and more of an idea. As early as his famous William Woods College talk in 1954, a decade before his formal emergence as a political force in his remarkable and widely noticed 1964 Rendezvous with Destiny speech, written to support the Goldwater campaign. What I began to discern through what he revealed to me and by what my outsized curiosity about him could piece together as I watched him, worked with him, and traveled with him around this country and the world was that his covert spirituality and faith translated into a sort of metaphysical strategy that ran in parallel with a more public and formal political strategy, and for him, bolstered it. In his mind, these two elements conjoined, blended, or merged, and what emerged was Reagan's own unique brand and way of making decisions, often unfettered by official government constraints. It also inspired his soaring oratory. This blended strategy of the metaphysical strain together with the public policy strain that the public was aware of. Reagan practiced this mix even while sequestering the source and features of his deepest thinking. These were brilliantly left unannounced, unexposed, and unexplained to the public, and eventually to most of his biographers. Though the one thing the entire world could openly know through his overt flashing clash with the evil he called an empire was that Ronald Reagan held no deeper commitment and felt no greater calling than his absolute priority to rid the world of communism. This, he felt, would always be America's work to do, and therefore his work to do. And he would always rank it as number one on his list of things to do and to accomplish. It was first placed there as early as the 1950s, long before he lived above the store, not the one in Tampico, Illinois, with his family growing up, but this time the one with whitewashed columns in Washington, D.C. So the fire that brisk early evening in Geneva had been stoked by an accommodating, mostly French-speaking houseman left behind and vetted by the Secret Service by the Aga Khan, the spiritual leader of a sect of Shia Muslims, whom we had persuaded to loan us his handsome but compact limestone villa known as Maison du Cesseur and located on the western shores of Lake Geneva. This was to be home for the Reagans during the first bilateral meeting between the world's two great superpowers. The Aga Khan and his elegant wife, Sally, whom I had met on several trips to Geneva to negotiate with the Soviets and to cement other details about the bilateral meeting, decamped to their London townhouse. Everything rested on the outcome of this meeting. The world was watching. Reagan had not one, but two strategies to end the Cold War and to help rid the world of totalitarianism and tyranny. And he brought them to that cosmopolitan city by the lake where, by now, thousands of journalists had set up studios and broadcast centers. One strategy was well known to the public. The other, he revealed to me in secret that evening in front of the fire. The three-part strategy managed by the State Department, the Pentagon, and the NSC, and supported by the president, included an aggressive military buildup, economic sanctions, and assertive diplomatic initiatives. But Reagan had an additional plan that was not official government policy, but one based on his long view of history, governed by divine providence. For if you remember anything about Reagan, it should be that his view of the future was enabled by two influences. First, the fundamental principles of the founders, who called the early settlers God's candlesticks, and pronounced on landing in Plymouth that the eyes of the world were on this small, weary, yet courageous band, and that this new community was in fact a shining city on a hill, with a light that would bring liberty to the rest of the world. and second, that to him, this teenage lifeguard of the Rock River and this graduate of Eureka College, divine providence absolutely rules in the affairs of men, and that ultimately good would always prevail, that right will defeat wrong, that liberty will outlast tyranny. Reagan looked way back to America's founding in order to look way ahead to see its future, to paraphrase Winston Churchill. These are things Reagan told me, and what I pieced together of what was going on in that character he so confidently sheltered. I came to see that these two influences also fueled Reagan's unbridled optimism. So I asked the president my question as we warmed ourselves by the fire that chilly November night. Nancy Reagan dressing upstairs, we waiting for the Gorbachevs to arrive for dinner. A small but elegant affair on which the two couples dined by candlelight with a small group of officials from both sides on plates we had made especially for the occasion, red-rimmed with the signatures of the two leaders in gold in the middle. Mine went sadly missing some time ago. Looking back on that evening, I'm not sure what gave me the courage or the daring to ask, but I thought I would put my theories to a test, just as I had when I asked him if he actually read that big worn-out Bible that sat next to the red phone on his nightstand. "Oh, yes," he said, as he showed me his handwriting in the margins. And then he read his favorite passages to me from the Bible. This was not unlike his later response to my inquiry into whether he had any favorite church hymns, whereupon he sang them to me. So I forged ahead as we sat there in front of the fire. "Mr. President," I spirited, trying to act nonchalant and not breaking with our relaxed tempo, "what do you honestly think will, in reality, bring down the tyranny of Soviet-style communism and Eastern Bloc totalitarianism once and for all? Will it be our three-part public strategy?" Now, why did I need to know if there was anything more than what the public already knew? I was aware that he had been secretly tutored by the celebrated author of The Land of the Firebird, Suzanne Massey, in 17 off-the-record sessions in the White House. She had briefed him on the essence of the Russian people and their culture, and she shared with him that Gorbachev was perhaps himself a man of some faith. Reagan gently caught my pass and threw it right back to me. And with that deep but unaffected, resonant and resolute voice, he said without skipping a beat, "Oh, Jim, there is only one way. It will all be brought to a permanent end, and this is how. It will be done by the people themselves. It will be done by the people themselves because of their mounting and desperate need to know freedom, because of their desperate need to know God." Just then, the Secret Service announced that the Gorbachev motorcade was pulling up to the front door, and the rest is history, starting with the first one-on-one meeting alone in a cottage near the villa, where the two most powerful men in the world laid the foundation of their relationship on faith, values, and character. It was almost 2 years later when he went to the Brandenburg Gate and called for the wall to come down. By that time, he knew that Gorbachev would respond, could respond, and that Reagan was giving him the cover to let it be done. For me, I had gone away from that evening in Geneva with something profound to hold in my heart all these years, to ponder, and yes, to see history confirm that, in fact, Reagan was right, and the people did begin their drive for liberty in the churches throughout Eastern Europe. This has been widely reported and documented, but in an interesting turn of events, while I was working in Berlin after the wall fell, the East Germans told me about this themselves. In closing, my friends, I would say that while Reagan's most famous words were the six that called for a specific wall to come down, words that had been eliminated in every draft of the speech by his governmental advisors, for me, it is the words that appear later in the speech that are the most critical to examine today. In these phrases, I believe Reagan was calling for, true to his practice, all walls to come down. Walls that separate a man from freedom, faith, and love. Reagan, you see, was a freedom fighter. He fought to bring down walls wherever he found them and to open doors to a brighter future. He knew the Berlin Wall would come down, but he wanted every wall of partition removed. He loved and commented upon in his speech the graffiti on the wall nearby, which read, "This wall will come down. Beliefs become reality." A couple of months ago, while I was speaking in a New England town, I found myself engaged in a conversation with a brilliant young high school junior named Jake Bradstreet. I could soon see that he was an avid student of history, and though he had been persecuted and threatened at his public high school for being a conservative, had a hunger to learn more about Ronald Reagan so that he could emulate him. In the weeks that have followed, he has written me several emails, but none I cherish more than the one I share with you all now. Here is but a small part of what he wrote me recently. A few weeks ago, I interviewed my grandmother about her life and the impact the United States had on her. She grew up in an aristocratic household in fascist and then Nazi Austria. Their family lost everything, and through God's intercession, ended up here together in the U.S. When I asked her who her favorite American was, she immediately said, "Ronald Reagan." I asked her to elaborate. She said, "My people, the Germans, fought a war against communism and they lost. It split us in half. It took not only all that my family had, but our people's spirit. When I saw the Berlin Wall come down, I was overjoyed to see my people united again. The great man who did that was Ronald Reagan. He was God's worker." May we all follow the footsteps of our 40th president and be God's workers. May we all be workers for freedom, workers for character, for the American ideal and its future, for selflessness, and for love. God bless Ronald Reagan, and God bless Eureka College. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, Jim, for that beautiful, beautiful speech. And on this impressive, historic day, November 9th, celebration of the fall of the Berlin Wall. Couldn't be prouder to have you with us and to have our family, the Eureka College family, together as we commemorate. I need pay just one more compliment and word of gratitude to the man who conceived of the idea of the fall of the wall back in 2009, and the man who gave the thumbs up to doing it. The one who conceived it is known to all of us, but very few people know that he actually came up with the idea. Now, he was a 22-year veteran of the United States Navy. He knew a little something about pride and country, and on this Veterans Week, he knew a little something about that, but his name is Mike Murtaugh, and we say thank you, Mike, for coming up with the idea of the fall of the wall. And of course, we say thank you to the man who was your boss at the time for saying, okay, Dave Arnold. But thank you both, gentlemen. On behalf of President Wright and all of us here at the Eureka College family, thank you so much for coming to the Fall of the Wall. Now, if you would rise and join America's best chorale, the Eureka College Chorale, in the singing of the Eureka College alma mater. Thank you very much. Mr. Rosebush will be in the lobby afterwards. Students, I encourage you to go by and shake his hand and meet him and welcome him. For any of you interested, we have for sale discount in the bookstore, Mr. Rosebush's book, True Reagan. But please go by and say hello to him. And if we can allow the Rosebushes to go out first so they can get positioned at the table for anyone who would like to come by. We very much appreciate that. Thank you all for coming. God bless.